Good afternoon, and welcome to the 2024 Annual General Meeting of the Municipal Pension Plan. My name is Donna Lohmer, and I am honored to be serving as the Chair of the Municipal Pension Board of Trustees. Thank you for joining us today. It is with gratitude that I acknowledge that we are hosting this event on the traditional and unceded territory of the Lekwungen people, also known as the Songhees and Esquimalt First Nation communities. We acknowledge and give thanks for their stewardship, care, and leadership on these lands. Today, we'll cover some important topics and make sure you have time to ask questions. You will hear that the plan is strong, steady, and sustainable. No matter what stage you are at in your life, you can be certain the plan will be there for you when you need it. Now, it is my pleasure to introduce to you the plan's Executive Director, Chelsea Kittleson. She's our moderator today. Welcome, Chelsea.
Thanks, Donna. It's such a pleasure to be here. As you know, as Executive Director, I have three main functions that I fulfill as Executive Director. First is supporting the Board of Trustees in their important duties. Second is overseeing the work of the office, our plan's agents, service providers, and third, executing on the comprehensive strategic plan that the board has set. It's my pleasure to moderate the discussion with some of our trustees like yourself here today. But before we start that discussion, I want to share a video where we're going to hear from members and employers about what being part of the plan means to them. After that, we're going to come back to our panel, and we're going to share some information about the plan's financial performance, the many responsible investing activities that we have underway, and what's ahead in our strategic plan. Then we're going to be joined by Gordon Fyfe, the CEO and Chief Investment Officer at BCI, who's going to be giving us an update as the plan's investment manager. And then we're going to move into the question and answer session, where we look forward to answering the questions that our viewers have about the Municipal Pension Plan. So let's kick off with the video and hear what the plan means to members and employers like you.
The pension was a lot higher than I thought it would be initially. It's given me a lot of options. Luckily, I got, knock on wood, still got my health, and I play pickleball. I do a lot of hiking as well, and I like to travel. So with that pension, that really helps with all of those things. So you don't think about it when you're younger. I know I didn't. It's just, it's amazing how it's really benefited me in my retirement.
Be a wise person today to ensure a comfortable retirement and that I can retire when I want to. At Central Saanich, we're seeing a lot of folks retire right now. There's a changing of the guard, and so I'm getting to watch firsthand what stepping into retirement looks like for other people. And it gives me an idea then of how to get ready myself and, like a sneak peek into the future and what it means to no longer have to exchange time for money.
I find having that defined pension plan extremely comforting, knowing what's coming in. That sort of defines me. I've always been someone who needs to know what's coming in, and having that defined pension is really, really comforting. The pension plan has always been at the center of our retirement plan. The deductions from my paycheck were always just part of it, and I knew they were going to a good place.
I think it gives us a leg up on some other employers. Some younger employees, the first thing they say to me is, "I don't want to contribute. You're taking too much money off my paycheck. I would like to spend that." I do like to try to talk to those employees and explain to them the value of that. That the pension plan, you're already at least doubling your contribution because your employer is matching that or actually a little bit more. The value of that municipal pension plan is just unmatched in the private sector, even if they're matching RRSP contributions.
We have two kids. They have a lot of activities they want to do. And prior to the pension, it was pretty stressful, to be honest. And now that I have the pension, I don't really worry about it anymore. It just happens. It just comes out. I don't worry. Giving us the freedom to put our money into other things, potentially, that we would have normally just plowed into RRSPs or savings. So selfishly, we can spend some of that money on traveling now, which we didn't really have the opportunity to do before. Our entire retirement plans are based upon having a guaranteed income.
just knowing that I had an income when I did retire, you know, a set income, and it was always going to be there. It's allowed me to do a few things in my retirement that I really didn't expect to be doing. It was one of my dreams when I was younger, in my 20s, I would see the Catalinas, you know, out there on the water, and I thought, you know, that I would like to have a Catalina someday. I can just rest assured and just enjoy the retirement years.
I hope you enjoyed the video. Some of you will have actually just seen that video twice because we were having some technical difficulties, but we do appreciate your patience. So in that video, you got an opportunity to hear from some of our members and employers and what it means for them to be a part of the municipal pension plan. Now we're going to have an opportunity to hear from some of our trustees about the work that they are doing for the plan. So I'd like to introduce them. You heard from Donna at the beginning of our meeting. We also have with us Hillary Brown, who's a long-serving trustee on the board, and she's filling in today for Gary Yee, who unfortunately wasn't able to be here. And also joining me is Harpinder Sandhu, who's the chair of our investment committee. So at the start, Donna, you told us about how you're the chair of the board, and I was hoping we could just take the opportunity for you to introduce yourselves a little bit more, tell us about your background and your role on the board, and what you enjoy about being a trustee. So Donna, why don't you kick us off?
Thanks, Chelsea. Yes, I've been a trustee since 2017, with last year serving as vice chair. I'm now happily retired after spending most of my career in healthcare, where I was the former VP and CFO of Interior Health Authority. My son is following in my footsteps in healthcare, and my daughter's studying to be a teacher. We're a family that definitely appreciates the value of a pension. Hillary.
Thank you. So my name is Hillary Brown, and I've been on the board since 2012. So that's almost 13 years. It's gone by very, very quickly. I have had the privilege of serving as both chair and vice chair for many of those 13 years. I too am now retired and enjoy spending time with both my older grown-up children and my two grandchildren.
I'm Harpinder Sandhu, and I work at CUPE as a research representative. We've got about 10 years of experience in pension benefits. I've joined the MPP board in 2019, and I serve as the chair of the investment committee. So I have a passion for responsible investing, and I'm also the co-chair of the UN Principles of Responsible Investing committee focused on ESG issues.
Great. Well, thanks very much to all three of you for being here. We're so lucky to have your experience and expertise on the board along with your 29 trustee colleagues. Now we're going to move on to find a little bit more about the plan. 2023 was a good year financially for the pension plan, and there's a number of reasons why that was. And to help summarize, Donna, I'm going to ask you to just highlight a few key figures and numbers about what 2023 was all about.
Sure. Thanks, Chelsea. As you noted, 2023 was a strong year for the plan. As of December 31st, 2023, the plan had $77 billion in net assets. That's an increase of more than $5 billion from 2022. We saw strong investment returns despite a challenging market, resulting in $5.6 billion in investment revenues. Finally, we paid out $2.5 billion to members and beneficiaries last year. As you can see, the investment revenue outpaced payments, which contributed to the growth and strength of the plan. Our plan is good value. Put simply, for every pension dollar you are receiving or will receive, you will have paid 12 and a half cents, and your employer matches that 12 and a half cents. The remainder, about 75 cents, comes from plan investments. This is great value. Now, I appreciate that's a very high-level overview of the plan. If anyone is interested in more detail about the plan, you're invited to read the 2023 annual report. It is available on the plan website, which is on your screen. And remember, there's an opportunity to ask questions at the end of the session.
Thanks, Donna. I certainly have come to know that there's a lot of numbers in pensions, so thanks for helping us focus on a few key ones. And Hillary, I'm going to ask you to take us for a little bit of a deeper dive into the investment performance for 2023.
Yes, so When we talk about the performance investment of our pension plan in 2023, the first thing I think of is what does it really mean to our members? Many of you are probably wondering, how can we be confident that the plan will pay our pensions consistently over time? When I reflect on this, I think of some of the oldest members we have. Some of those people are over 100 years old now, which means they've been receiving their pensions for over 40 years. This exemplifies the very foundation of our plan. We prepare now for the future. The board takes a long-term view in managing the pension fund, and this philosophy allows us to navigate the inevitable short-term ups and downs of the economy. Decisions made in prior years have positioned us to remain on the right path, ensuring stability and growth for the members' pensions. One key aspect of our strategy is the long-term required rate of interest investment return, which is currently set at 6.25%. This rate serves as a benchmark for our investment performance. And I'm pleased to share that for the 2023 year, the plan actually returned a very impressive 7.7%, exceeding our objective of 6.25%. Furthermore, when we look at the 10-year return, it also continues to exceed the objectives as well. That showcases our commitment to a long-term growth and stability. With the assistance of our actuary and our investment manager, we continually monitor and to make sure that it meets the pension's promise, ensuring that we're well positioned to support our members' needs. While we do anticipate some volatility in the short term, of course, that's to be expected. We maintain a long-term perspective in our discussions and our decision makings. This strategic approach allows us to navigate the ups and downs in the economy very effectively, as I mentioned before. But I think the important message that I want to leave to our viewers today is that our plan is performing very well, and we're in a very solid position to provide the pensions that all our members rely on. Our proactive strategies and long-term focus ensure that we can fulfill our commitment to each of you, both now and in the years to come.
Already this afternoon, we've underscored the importance of investment returns to the plan. 75 cents of every pension dollar comes from investment returns. And Harpinder, as chair of the investment committee, you're familiar with all the work that the board does in terms of its oversight of investments. I hope that you can give us a little bit more visibility into how do we make investment decisions.
Sure. So as Donna and Hillary mentioned, our duty is to our members. So we place care and consideration on how to best do this at the investment committee and our board meetings. And we seek out advice from experts, including BCI, to make the decisions in the best financial interest of our members. It's also important for the board to set a diversified investment portfolio. A diversified portfolio means that the plan's assets are invested in multiple asset types, industries, and geographies. And this means that volatility or negative performance in any one area does not significantly impact the total portfolio. So, as of fiscal year 2023, BCI manages a majority of the assets in-house and is well positioned to take a long-term approach to investing and also make the quick decisions when needed.
The recent numbers for inflation in Canada have been released, and we know that a lot of the members are feeling the strain of rising costs. So Don, I'm wondering, what can the pension plan be doing to help members pensioned against the rising costs?
Yeah, thanks, Chelsea. It's important to the board, to our board, to position the plan so that pensions paid out grow over time rather than stay a fixed amount. To illustrate this, you can see in this example, the original pension grew by $10,000 over the 20-year period with the enhancement of a cost of living adjustment, or what we refer to as COLA. Providing COLAs that are sustainable over the long term and within the long-term funding capacity is a priority of the board. Even though within the plan rules, COLAs aren't guaranteed, we annually consider whether the plan can afford to provide a COLA up to the change in the Canadian Consumer Price Index that is expressed for the 12-month period ending September of each year. That was a mouthful. We announce the amount of the COLA, if we're granting a COLA, by the beginning of January each year. In addition to this annual check-in, every 3 years, we do a financial health check of the plan called an actuarial valuation. In previous years, there was a cap in place to ensure what we paid out in COLA was affordable. Given that the results of the last valuation were extremely positive and inflation reserves were healthy, we were able to remove the cap in 2023 to the COLA. This allowed us to provide an increase to the pensions to match inflation, which, as we know, were very high at the time. We regularly monitor the financial health of the plan, and if there's any indication that increasing pensions paid to match CPI puts the plan in jeopardy, then a cap will be reinstated. We appreciate caps are not always popular, but at times necessary to ensure we can deliver on the pension promise, not only to current retirees, but to our members who will retire in the future. Rest assured, your plan is in good hands. The board is focused on making sure the plan remains sustainable for everyone who relies on it today and in the future.
Let's now shift the conversation to another topic, responsible investing, also called ESG. And Harpinder, the investment committee spends a lot of time thinking about its approach to responsible investing. Can you help us connect the dots around how responsible investing helps support the board in best financial interest to the plan members?
Sure. So, Chelsea, this has been a board focus for many years. In fact, since about 2007, when we became signatory to an organization called PRI, Principles of Responsible Investing, which is an international network of investors working together on responsible investment. When we talk about responsible investment, we also use the term ESG as shorthand. And this means environmental, social, and governance factors that can affect a company's performance. So both the board and the investment agent, BCI, believe that companies with strong ESG practices are better positioned to create long-term value. ESG is applied as a lens to better understand and manage the risks, at the same time take advantage of opportunities.
So back in 2022, the board announced a net zero goal by 2050, which means that the investment portfolio would not be contributing to greenhouse gas emissions. Harpinder, can you tell us a little bit more about that?
Yes. So for climate change, we do consider this very important as an ESG factor. We're also taking action by setting a goal. So for example, we have an interim target of 55% reduction in the portfolio's carbon footprint by 2030. That is a milestone on our way towards net zero by 2050. So we are making progress. The plan portfolio decreased its carbon footprint by 23% compared with the 2020 baseline. Methodology and fluctuations and asset mix can affect year-to-year results, so keep that in mind. But at the same time, overall, we're on the correct path. We are very transparent about our goals, and we track against them. And our annual report also gives lots of detail for those who would like to read more about this. The board has been very thoughtful and diligent about this approach to responsible investing, especially climate issues and net zero goal. So we take time to monitor progress and find appropriate opportunities to engage with the companies with the help of BCI. Additionally, we continue to educate ourselves to be good stewards of the plan and consider all risks, including climate change. So, for example, we collaborated with experts to create a climate change orientation package for new trustees. And as a board, we also advocate regularly for better policies. Just one example is this summer we signed on an investor statement supporting Climate Action 100+. So this is a premier collaborative to ensure the biggest corporate emitters act on climate change. It's a major impact. This is a journey on which we applied a solid effort for many years. That effort continues, and we'll share progress with members at future annual general meetings.
Well, as you mentioned, Harpinder, it's a journey. And so I have no doubt that at future AGMs, we'll be talking about this more. And of course, we'll continue to publish information about our activities on the website and in the annual report. Hillary, you've been on the board for a number of years, and so you've seen several strategic plans and been a part of that process. Can you tell us why it's important to the board to have strategic plans?
Yes, absolutely, and that's a good question. So the board strategic plan, what it does is it sets out our vision and our long-term goals for the plan's future. It has very specific objectives and the work that we want to do and achieve in the coming few years. The strategic plan also ensures that we're tracking and mitigating risks, because that's very, very important as well. In short, the board's planning process helps us to determine what we should do today to prepare for tomorrow. For example, like our net zero goal, which Harp was just talking about.
Thanks, Hillary. So in our current three-year strategic plan, what are the goals that the board has set out?
Yeah, so for right now we're working with our 2023-2026 strategy, and we have three objectives that we're focusing on right now. The first one is to be a leading responsible investor. It's very important to our board. The second is to continue to strengthen the plan's awareness, and the third one is to gain advantage with size. These are very big objectives, but we do have a plan to get there.
Thanks. Harpinder, you talked earlier about the net zero goal. What else is the board working on in terms of being a leading responsible investor?
Thanks, Chelsea. Yes, so we're driving towards responsible investing strategies across all asset classes, so promoting overall plan sustainability. We also want to be regarded as a responsible investment leader, so continuing our climate change disclosures and helping set responsible investment standards. I operate our investment committee as a space to encourage ongoing education to trustees so that we can better make decisions in this space.
Great. Hillary, can you tell us a little bit more about objective two around plan awareness?
Yes. So there's so much communication that we have to do, and right now we're actively improving our communication with new and younger members to ensure that they understand the value of the pension plan, particularly for those who are considering joining. I mean, for example, when I was younger, pensions didn't mean anything to me. Retirement seemed so far away. But at the same time, we're also having to make sure that our communications are strong with our plan partners, our appointing authorities, other public sector pension plans, regulators, and policymakers, as these partnerships are crucial for the effective governance that we have. Additionally, we're exploring some research initiatives to showcase the strength of the plan.
And Donna, can you tell us about the third objective?
Sure. The third objective, gaining advantage with size. We believe in the value of the plan and want to bring that value to as many people as we can. We've been working to increase our membership by reviewing enrollment eligibility rules for non-full-time employees, encouraging employees to enroll when they become eligible, and consider how we can attract new employers to participate in the plan. If you're an employer and are interested in offering the plan to more employees, please reach out to the plan.
Thank you, Donna, Hillary, and Harpinder, for all your contributions today. As we've shared, the board has a lot on the go, and I know we're all happy to be here today to share how we are working together to prepare for tomorrow. And someone who is helping us prepare for tomorrow has just joined us, Gordon Fife, who is going to give us the bigger picture on the investment climate. Gordon has been a regular at our AGMs to tell us what's happening in the world of investments. So we're really delighted that you can be here today, Gordon.
Well, thank you, Chelsea. And it's nice to be back again this year. And, you know, I've been now CEO and CIO, Chief Executive Officer and Chief Investment Officer of BCI for 10 years, since 2014, and I'm joined today by Jennifer Coulson, who will be joining us during question period, who runs the large and growing ESG team at BCI. So as you heard, your plan's investment returns over the last 10 years have averaged 7.8% per year in each of those years, which is has basically more than doubled the assets during that period. Now that 7.8% has outperformed the benchmark of 7%, and is significantly above the actuarial hurdle rate of 6.25%. And this outperformance of the benchmark, if I convert that into dollars, is a value-added creation over that 10-year period of just over $4 billion coming from the investment decisions that we've made. Now, that's looking back, but if I turn and look forward a bit, I'm going to turn first to the economy. And the question we're all facing is, are we going to have a soft landing or a recession? Well, last year when I was here, we were worrying about rate rises. Are we going to have more rate hikes from the Bank of Canada? In fact, we're now in an environment of rate cuts. Inflation was reported, as you mentioned, on Tuesday of this week, and inflation has dropped down well below the 2% target rate for the Bank of Canada to 1.6%. So the Bank of Canada is meeting next week. And I think we're pretty safe to assume that there's going to be a 50 basis point or a 0.5% rate cut, and he may even surprise us with more. And I say that because Governor Macklem is aware that there are a lot of people starting in the first half of next year who bought homes when COVID first started and rates were very, very low, and they financed these new homes at very, very low rates. And if they're going to roll their mortgages after 5 years next year, it's going to be quite painful. So I'm quite sure that he's going to cut as far and as fast as he can based on what the data will allow him to do. So if you have a mortgage, whether it's a floating mortgage or you're about to renew, I think relief is coming and getting closer. The USA, it's not quite so easy. Inflation in the US is still around 3%. If you're looking at core inflation, it's a little bit below 3%. If you're looking at CPI, which includes food and energy and other things, it's still quite a bit above 3%. But the Fed has a dual mandate. The central bank in the US has a dual mandate, unlike in Canada, where our bank is only focused on inflation. In the United States, the central bank has also got to pay attention to employment. So in the past, the inflation ceiling for the Federal Reserve in the US was 2%. And what's happened now is rather than that 2% being a ceiling for inflation, it's actually becoming and expected to become a floor for inflation. So we expect to see inflation above that. So that's not great for the Canadian dollar because it means structurally interest rates in the US could be above those in Canada for some time. And we've actually seen the Canadian dollar weakening. So unlike the Tuesday inflation number in Canada, which was below expectations, the last inflation number in the U.S. was actually above expectations. So why is the U.S. growing so much faster? Well, you raise interest rates at the central bank because you're trying to constrain people from spending. Well, what happens is that actually 40% of homeowners in the United States don't have a mortgage. And 60% of those that do have a mortgage are paying an interest rate of less than 4%. And remember, in the US, you can get a 30-year mortgage. So they've locked in some very long-term low rates for some time. But also, in addition to that, the US government's running a very large deficit. In fact, this is the largest deficit, peacetime deficit, in the history of the United States. So they're spending a lot of money, which stimulates growth as well. In addition to that, there's low unemployment. These are bringing back concerns that maybe inflation in the US isn't dead, and wage and settlements are coming in above inflation. You know, China has been exporting deflation for decades, but now we're putting tariffs on a lot of the things that they're exporting to us. And tariffs basically raise the price of whatever we're buying from them. And so we won't be getting as much deflation out of China as we have in the past. And also the strong stock markets. Markets are at pretty close to all-time highs, and I'll come back to that in a moment. But if we're invested in the stock market and the prices are very high, we feel wealthy. So we go out and spend more than we might if the stock markets were weak. And finally, there's a Middle East war going on, and if that is to escalate at all, we could expect to see oil prices going back up. So all of these things are contributing to the risk that inflation is maybe not dead in the U.S. yet, so we're watching it. So we expect that we'll see more rate cuts in Canada, but maybe fewer than might have been expected even up until recently in the U.S. Moving from the economy into the markets, as I said, the North American stock markets are at or near all-time highs. Now, a lot of that has been driven by a few AI, artificial intelligence stocks that have really pushed the indices higher. But still, many of the companies' valuations are still pretty good in the markets as inflation has really boosted their revenues and their profits. But the question is, are they prepared for a shock or a disappointment going forward? So they're priced pretty high right now, because right now they're ignoring the fact that there are two military wars going on. There's one economic war with China going on. Huge growing government debts, particularly in the US. China is slowing down, and Europe is also quite weak. So what are the implications for the BCI portfolio and your pension fund? Well, BCI has built a portfolio of very long-term, high-quality core assets, and it is very well diversified between different types of assets. So if the markets fall, we're going to have no choice. We're going to have to mark the value of those assets down, and that's fine. That's an accounting entry. But the trick is not to be forced to sell those assets, because if we don't sell it, then we're not locking in the loss. And when the markets turn around, we'll ride them back up again. Rather, BCI, we manage our liquidity very, very carefully. And we've got the capacity not only to hold on to these assets if the markets do decline, but when other investors get into trouble because they've not managed their liquidity as well, we'll be there to buy from them and buy at very attractive prices. So right now, we're waiting. As I mentioned to you last year, the deal flow was very, very slow, but it's coming back right now. And so we're picking up some interesting assets as we speak, and we're ready. And a lot of that's coming from the strategy that we put in place over the last 10 years. And it's prepared us for pretty much whatever is going to come forward. And over the last 10 years, we've been diversifying into more markets, more countries, and more asset classes, more types of assets to allow us to diversify. And we've brought, as was mentioned, we've brought a lot more of the investment decision-making in-house. So we've built our own teams. And this has saved our BCI clients nearly $2.5 billion in fees since 2016. So that's money we would have paid to outside managers, which are often up to 10 times more expensive than when we do something internally. Now, what's interesting is that's $2.5 billion for organization overall. Municipal share of that is about $850 million since 2016, which instead of paying out to the people who come and see us in their private jets, is actually flowing through to your pension account. So overall though, BCI is a low-cost manager among our Canadian peers. BCI costs are $300 million a year lower than the average of the big pension funds in Canada. That's not $300 million a year less than the most expensive manager. That's $300 a year less than the average of the other seven big pension funds in Canada. And as I told you last year, a penny saved at BCI buys our pensioners as much as a penny earned. So looking forward, we're continuing to find ways to add value. I mentioned last year opening some foreign offices. Our New York office now is over 30 people, focused mainly on U.S. Private equity, but also we've got some public markets people there as well. And our London office is expanding. We're just over 10 people, and we're continuing to build that. And we've added one wonderful lady in Mumbai to take care of some of our Indian assets. We're also continuing to expand our private credit activities and now moving into asset-backed credits, and we're also starting to partner with some Indigenous bands. So I'm going to turn to my last topic, which is sustainability. I know we've covered a bit of that today, and Jennifer is here during question period to answer some more questions on it. But BCI's ESG team is nearly 20 people with a variety of backgrounds, and they're working with our investment teams first, looking at all the risks and the opportunities and making sure that all of that's considered. But they're also making sure that we're being good stewards of the assets that we, in fact, do buy. And our Climate Action Plan, which is a public document, and you can find it on our website, it outlines how we engage with companies, how we vote our proxies, and how we collaborate with other funds to bring about change and set standards to help guide the transition. Again, I'm going to say this, ESG, though, is not just about evaluating and overseeing the existing investments, but it also includes finding opportunities in the transition. And we've invested in battery storage companies, wind and solar companies, and others that are a part of the transition. But BCI doesn't make these investment decisions in a vacuum, and we need the regulatory environment to support the transition so that we can deliver the returns expected by our clients. And we are accountable to municipal and to our other clients as defined by our legislation, which requires BCI to act in your best financial interests. We're not accountable to the interest groups who are not fiduciaries of these funds and try to use your pensions to further their agendas. And divestment, which we often get approached about divestment, it is not an effective strategy to achieve climate goals. All it does is transfer the ownership of some of these assets into hands of investors that are certainly less responsible than we are. And it also removes resources from high-emitting sectors that are trying to transition to a low carbon. So in the end, divestment, it may make people feel better, but it actually doesn't help the world, and depending on who's buying the assets that you're selling, it could actually make it worse. So I'm going to close by just mentioning that BCI is recognized frequently for its climate work, and most recently, we were one of only two global funds out of 200 to receive a grading of 100% by the Global Sovereign Wealth Fund Post, ranking governance, sustainability, and resiliency. And we've also been recognized in 2024 for a PRI award for recognition of action on climate, which is for collaborating on a program focused on reducing methane emissions and oil and gas. So I'm out of time, so I'm going to hand it back to you, Chelsea. Thank you very much for having me this year.
That's great. Thanks, Gordon. Appreciate those insights. And Gordon's going to be staying around for the Q&A session. So if you today online have questions, just a reminder that there is a button at the bottom of your screen where you can enter those questions. But before we get to the question and answer section, we'd like to use a polling feature so that you can let us know what you found most interesting during this panel discussion. So while that information comes up, I wanted to let you know that we have a few other guests who are joining us for the Q&A section. They're just sitting here to my left. We have Jennifer Coulson from BCI, who heads up their Responsible Investing Group. We have Catherine Robertson from Eckler, who is the plan actuary. We have Aaron Walker-Duncan, who is from BC Pension Corporation. From Municipal Retiree Benefit Trust, Bonnie Pearson, and Monique Klein from Pacific Blue Cross. And I just wanted to mention that unfortunately we cannot answer any questions in this forum that are of a personal nature, but I would encourage you to go onto the plan website if you have any questions regarding the pension, or reach out to the Municipal Retiree Benefit Trust if you have any questions around benefits. So thank you for all the questions, and thank you to our panelists. We're now going to move to our first question that has come in. So one of the big themes that has come up is the health of the pension plan, with members wondering if the plan is still going to be there when they're ready to retire. And the question actually for you, Gordon, is how is BCI helping the plan prepare for any upcoming economic difficulties?
I think I covered a lot of that in my prepared statements, but I think if you're looking for a sense of confidence in what can the plan withstand, I think you need to look back through time. And this plan has gone through some pretty difficult markets and economies. If you go back all the way to the dot-com bust in 2000, 2001, and then the really big one was the 2008-2009 GFC, Great Financial Crisis. You know, at one point during that, the S&P 500, the U.S. stock index, was down 62%. That's a pretty big fall in the valuation of the assets. And so the plan is, and the portfolio, as I said, is very well, very, very well diversified. We have an amazing process for managing our liquidity, and we do that daily to make sure that we're never squeezed to have to sell something we don't want to sell. We will sell assets, but we want to sell them when we want to sell them, not when we're forced to sell them at some depressed price. But we're also be able to buy assets cheap when we enter into those sort of markets. So this plan has already been through a lot, which should give everyone confidence that whatever the world's going to throw at us over the next 20 years, it's not going to be any worse than what we've seen in the last 24 years.
So we talked earlier about cost of living adjustments, or COLAs for short, and we've had quite a few questions about what the COLA will be for 2025. Donna, can you help us with that question?
Sure, thank you. September inflation number was just released yesterday, or the day before, and so the board will make its decision about COLA later this year once we've had an opportunity to take all factors into consideration and run all our numbers. And the COLA will be posted on the plan website by January 1st, and also in the retired members' newsletter at that time.
Great. There are some questions coming in around investing in certain categories. And there are some concerns that people have expressed around investments in certain industries. As I said, Jennifer Coulson is just sitting here off to my left. So Jennifer, I'm going to ask you if you can help us with that question.
Great, thanks, and good afternoon, everyone. I can certainly understand the concern coming through in the question, just given some of the events we're dealing with today around the world, whether that's conflict in Ukraine or the Middle East, other geopolitical issues, as well as concerns around climate change long term. So from an organizational standpoint, I think you've heard today how aligned MPP and BCI are in terms of our commitment to responsible investing. So I'll just go a little bit deeper maybe into some of our policies and processes to really get at the question. And I think the first thing to reinforce is our very strict financial mandate. So we are not able to take political positions or infuse our own personal value judgments when we are making investment decisions. So that means we do not have a blanket divestment approach, as Gordon has already mentioned, for things like aerospace and defense or oil and gas. These are probably two of the most common concerns that I hear from clients over the years. We do, however, adhere to international treaties covering the most dangerous weapons, so that is certainly in place. And I think the second thing to really explain to everyone is that we can invest both passively and actively. And when we invest passively, we're really just looking for that broad exposure to certain markets for diversification purposes. And those are not, we are not choosing individual securities when we make those investments. We are replicating a broad index. So think of something like the S&P 500. We are not choosing what goes in to that index. So we are replicating that index. However, if we look at the active side, this is where we are making those individual decisions, and we have much more control over the ESG performance of those companies that we decide to invest in. So anytime we're looking at an active investment, we're doing a full environmental, social, and governance review of those assets, looking at things like health and safety record, human rights issues, how is executive compensation structured, all of these things that we feel really will drive long-term financial performance. So those are factored into all of our investment decisions. The important thing to take away here is that we are very aligned with MPP, and I think for some that might be very concerned with climate change in particular, we do have our comprehensive climate action plan on the website, and there is also a paper, I understand, that is linked to the MPP website that really fully explains our approach to divestment versus engagement and why we don't think divestment is an effective tool. So if you're looking for more information, I would definitely check out some of those resources and engage in that conversation.
Thanks, Jennifer, and that's right, that thought leadership piece is on the MPP website. We've received some questions about the relationship between the pension plan and government. Specifically, does the pension plan create debt for the provincial government? And could either the provincial or federal government require the plan to switch from defined benefit, which we are currently, to defined contribution? Aaron Walker Duncan has long history with the plan, so I'm hoping you can take this one, Aaron.
Thanks, thanks, Chelsea, and good afternoon, everyone. Let me break this down into two parts. First question, does the pension plan create debt? Short answer is no. You will have seen earlier in the presentation in the investment portion where we showed the value of each dollar pension and where that dollar comes from, and you will have seen 12.5 cents or roughly 12.5 cents. A contribution comes from the member, and the other 12.5 cents comes from the employer. So that's the extent of the obligation. And the rest of the 75 cents comes from the investment returns, as was noted. As far as the powers of the provincial or federal government? Again, the answer is no. The provincial government is a key partner in the oversight of the municipal pension plan, along with two other partners, the Union of BC Municipalities and the Municipal Employees Pension Committee, which represents all the unions that participate in the, whose employees participate in the municipal pension plan. The plan has a very positive relationship with the plan partners. There's also historically, there's been very strong bipartisan support, and it continues to be very strong bipartisan support for the municipal pension plan and the defined benefit model, and we expect that to continue. And really, a lot of that support is based on the strong governance and sustainability of the pension plan, as led by the Board of Trustees, who you're hearing from today, you know, and the great work that they do in ensuring that the plan is sustainable and is well governed. There's also two very, very professional and strong agents in BCI and Pension Corporation who support the board in making sure that we can fulfill the plan can fulfill the pension promise to you as members.
We've had an important and fundamental question come in, which is how does the pension plan work, and where can members who are new to the world of pensions learn more? I know there is a wealth of resources on the plan website. So Aaron, I'm gonna ask if you can take that one.
Sure, yeah, that's a big question. We could spend a whole hour or more on something like that about how the plan works. You will have seen that there were two information sessions that that were held this morning before the AGM. Those will be posted. They've been recorded and they'll be posted on the website for people to refer to, so there's a great source. But really, the website is a great starting point. There's a lot of information about the pension plan on the website. Lots of resources. There's a growing learning library of videos, short videos, so people can go in and see in sort of bite-sized chunks. They can learn about different aspects of the pension plan, from everything from, you know, when you're a new member and you're, you know, the welcome to the plan and what you need to know, straight through to for those that are approaching retirement, what you need to know and what support's available. So, but in addition to the website, there's also webinars that people can sign up for and attend that are very informative. There's no cost to attend those, so you can attend them as many times as you like over the course of over your career as well.
We have a municipal retiree benefit question for Bonnie Pearson. We've heard from some members who have questions about what is covered under the extended health and dental coverage. So how can members learn more about what's covered and what's excluded? Bonnie, can I pass this over to you and Monique?
Sure, thanks, Chelsea. We have had a section of the Municipal Pension Plan website since we were founded. And I'm really happy to tell you that very recently, within the last week or 10 days, on the landing page of MPP, there is now a promotional box for the MRPD, and that box will take you right to new documents that give you the plan booklet and additional information. In addition to that, we've posted two new documents. One is called Benefits at a Glance. It's a quick one-pager, and the other one is a retirement guide for retirees. So I think both of those are really helpful. If you have individual questions, however, we encourage you to contact either BC Pension Corporation or Pacific Blue Cross with those individual questions. But I'm going to pass it to Monique, who can speak about the resources they also provide to plan members.
Thanks so much, Bonnie. It's a pleasure to be here today. So how can members get more information about what's included and what's excluded? If you are an MRBT member that's already registered, then the best way would be to go to our website at www.pac.bluecross.ca and log into your member profile. Your member profile includes a whole lot of information about the plan, including all of what's included, as well as information about what you perhaps have already claimed and when you can go claim again. So I'd encourage everyone to get familiar with your member profile online. Now, in addition to that, we have other resources available, including the MRBT PBC microsite, which is at www.pac.bluecross.ca/MRBT. And there, both members who have registered, as well as individuals that have not yet registered, if they're just curious about the plan, they can access that information as it's a public site. And you have access to booklet information, including all of the details of what's included and some of what's excluded, as well as a brochure that's available for review or printout. And there's a lot of information on the microsite. So I would encourage you to check out that microsite and keep coming back to it, because we update it on a regular basis, at least twice a year. We're adding articles that might be of interest to the retiree community, such as drug information or what's happening in the marketplace, travel information, and those articles might be of interest to you as well. So it's a great place to get additional information. I hope that answers your question.
We've heard from several members who are nearing retirement and are feeling overwhelmed about that life transition. And the questions that they ask are, how can they find out what their pension will look like in retirement? And where can they find more information about retirement planning? Aaron, I think you're really well positioned to help us with this question.
Sure. Thanks, Chelsea. I mean, when I think about retirement, it's one of the key transitions that people are going to have in life, from their working environment to becoming retired, and the plan is here to help and support members with that through that journey. I'm going to talk about four different elements to how we can help. First is, again, I referred to earlier, the plan website. There's a massive amount of information that's available for members. And in fact, for those that are approaching retirement, this year we launched a new video on 7 steps to retirement online. So if you haven't already gone and watched that video, we encourage you to do so. It'll hopefully help you to understand the steps in that journey. Second is My Account. My Account is the personal sort of section of the secure part of the website, where you can log in and you can see all your information about your pension plan and your entitlement. The My Account, you can confirm information that's available there, so your basic information about you and your family, your beneficiaries, that sort of thing. You can review past member benefit statements, so you can see what those annual statements look like. You can run pension estimates, which is probably the most critical part of that site for those that are approaching retirement. And you can put in various different scenarios, different retirement dates, different earnings expectation, that sort of thing. So you can see what your different pension values might look like, depending on certain options that you might want to select through that process. The third thing I would mention is our member service center. So we're there if members need to contact us. So if you can't find the information that you're looking for on the website, or you have a specific question about your own circumstance, we have a member service center where we can, you can call, or you can, through secure messaging within My Account, you can send an electronic message to us, and we will we'll respond and help you that way. And then the last thing that I'll mention is that we recently launched this year personal pension planning appointments. So for those members that are approaching retirement, you can pre-book a 30-minute appointment with a member of our team who will support you. It allows you to plan in advance. You can bring a spouse or a friend or perhaps an adult child or even a financial planner or advisor to the session to help you through that process. So all to say, lots of supports that are available for members. So if you are feeling overwhelmed, please don't. Please contact us and we are there to help.
We have questions about whether there are regular reports on the financial health of the plan. Specifically, members are wondering about regular actuarial valuations the plan does, and how do they contribute to the stability of the plan. Over to you, Catherine.
Thanks very much indeed, Chelsea, and thanks for the opportunity to be here today. Yes, the plan does undergo regular actuarial valuations. And those valuations help to ensure that there's enough money in the fund, and they help monitor the stability of the fund. The last valuation was conducted as of December 31st, 2021, and that showed that the fund was actually fully funded at that time. Now, Eckler is independent actuaries. We conduct those valuations, so we are actuaries that are specialised in doing those valuations. And we conduct those valuations at least every 3 years. So the next regular valuation of the plan will take effect as of the end of this year, December 31st, 2024.
Thanks, Catherine. Another question that I think you can help us with is, can you share some of the trends that you are seeing that affect pension plans?
Yeah, thanks again, Chelsea. I'll just actually mention that the next valuation, the results of that valuation will be reported out by the board in late 2025, so do keep an eye out for that. But on your question with regards to trends, that's certainly a very interesting question, one that I could talk to for quite some time. But we do monitor numerous trends continuously, so I'll perhaps just touch on two quite quickly. One that we continuously monitor is looking at long-term investment returns. As you've heard a lot today, we're managing the plan on a long-term basis. So we don't want to get too distracted by short-term fluctuations. Those will be taken into consideration when we do each valuation every 3 years, but we're really focusing on long-term expectations of where investment returns are headed. In order that we can ensure that there are enough funds in the plan to pay not only the current members that are in receipt of their pensions, but also for future retirees as well. And then I'll just touch quickly on another trend that we monitor, which is how long members are living. So you heard from Hillary earlier that there are an increasing number of members who are reaching that milestone of 100 years old. And obviously, the older a member is, then the longer their pension is in payment for. So it's a trend that we're continuing to monitor so we can ensure that the fund can support members and their beneficiaries for as long as they live.
Another theme of questions is how the plan is managed, who gets to make decisions, and how trustees are selected. Hillary, can you help us with that?
Yeah, absolutely. And I'll do it fairly quickly because I think we are getting old.
Yeah.
So very quickly, there's a joint trusteeship for our pension plan, and basically what that means is that there's representation from both members and employers. The plan partners and the appointing authorities appoint 16 primary trustees, and they can appoint 16 alternate trustees as well, so there can be up to 32 trustees at any given time. We manage our operations in line with the joint trustee agreement. And of course, we always follow best practices in terms of accountability, transparency, and ethical decision making. I did also mention our strategic plan, which is very important that we follow that. And that can be seen on our governance documents on our website if anybody is more interested in that strategic plan. So thank you.
Thanks for all your questions. And thank you to our experts who joined us today. A recording of our event is going to be published on the plan website. If you pre-registered, you're going to receive an email when the recording is available. And if there are any questions about topics that we weren't able to touch on today, we're going to address those on the plan website following the meeting. On the screen now, you're going to see a list of resources that were shared throughout the meeting.
That concludes our 2024 Annual General Meeting. Thank you to everyone who helped make this event possible. And to all of you for joining us today. Spread the word. Next year's annual general meeting is on October 16th, 2025. We look forward to seeing you online again next year. Coming up on your screen will be a short follow-up survey. We'd love to hear from you, so please stay online for that. Thank you. Have a great day.